Hello everyone, and welcome to the seventh tutorial in our series. In the previous lesson, we learnt how to create loops to repeat some code without having to write so much. In this lesson, we'll learn how to organise lots of data and information in structures called tables. So far, we've learnt how to create variables that act as containers which store a value such as a string or number. But let's say we have a list of items that we want to buy from a store. Storing each item we want to buy in separate variables would be incredibly inefficient, and it would become increasingly difficult to locate and edit items as the list continues to grow. Instead, we can organize all of this information and data in a table format. In a table, each item is assigned to a key starting from 1, the first key. As we add more items, the table continues to grow and assigns each new item to the next available key. And if you want to fetch an item from a table, we just need to use its key to locate it. Like this, we can group values together and make them easily accessible whilst keeping our code much more organized. To create a table, we use curly braces and write any values we want to store inside them. So let's create one for the list of items we want to buy. We'll start by creating a variable for our list, so local, we can name it grocery list. And we will assign it to a fresh table, so just these curly braces. So inside these curly braces, we're going to insert the items that we want to store in our table. Because we're making a list of items we want to buy, we will store a list of strings that represent those items. So our first item could be onion, our second item could be carrot, and our third item could be lettuce. So we've created a table which stores three strings: onion, carrot, and lettuce. Now let's print the grocery list. And now let's run the code. If you see a long string instead of a table like this, you just need to click on the three dots in the output widget and disable log mode. And then if you rerun the code, you should see our table. Now you can click on the arrow next to our table in output to expand it and see its contents. And we'll just expand the output a little bit to see it properly. We can see that each item we added to the table has been assigned a number key. So the first string we added to the table, which was onion, has been given the first key, key 1. The second string, carrot, has been given the second key of the table, key 2. And the third string, lettuce, has been given the third key in the table, key 3. And if we add a fourth item to our list, that should be given the fourth key. And there you go. We can also add a particular item to the table as many times as we like. Let's say one carrot isn't enough for us and we want to add some more. All we have to do is add the carrot string to the table as many times as we want, and each of them will be given their own key. Now let's test the code and expand the table. And you can see that these carrots have been given their own keys, 5 and 6. To fetch a specific item from a table, we have to use its key. So if we want to fetch the string onion from the table, we need to use its key in that table, which is number 1. So to do that, let's start by creating a variable for our item, so local item, and we will assign it to the first key of our grocery list table. So grocery list, and then square brackets 1, because that is the first key. Now let's print the item and test the code. And we can see that it has printed out onion, because onion has been assigned to the first key of our table. This is how we retrieve a specific item or value from a table. We simply write the name of the table and follow it with the key of the value we need. And in programming, this action is known as indexing. Let's try indexing the third key in the grocery list table and see what it prints. So we'll create another variable for that, local item equals grocery list. And we're going to index with the third key. Now let's print the item and test the code. And we can see it says lettuce, because lettuce has been assigned to the third key, because we added that into the table at the third place. We can edit our items in the list after creating it too. Let's say we change our minds and we don't want to buy an onion anymore. We want to buy some garlic instead. We can replace the onion by assigning the key in the table where the onion is stored to a new item. So let's just delete this and make our edits to the table. So let's assign the first key of the table to a new item, and our new item will be garlic. And then let's print the grocery list one more time and run our code. And let's just bring back our code and we'll just expand these tables. So in the beginning, the first key of our grocery list table stored the string onion. And when we printed out the value assigned to that key, it printed out onion. But then we changed our minds and we decided that we want to store garlic at the first key of the table instead. So once we made that change and reprinted the table, it now shows garlic is at the first key and onion is nowhere to be found in our list. So this is how we can replace items in the table. All we have to do is assign that key to a new value. And like this, we can add new items to the table too. Let's say we change our minds again and decide that we do want to buy an onion. We can add the onion to the end of our list. So we index the next available key, which will be 5, and we assign onion to it. So grocery list at key 5, and we will assign that to onion. Then let's print the grocery list one more time. And let's test the code. Let's just expand the output as well. So first the table had onion at key 1, carrot at key 2, lettuce at key 3, and potato at key 4. Then we made a change. We decided that we do not want to buy an onion anymore, and we want to buy some garlic instead. So we changed the first key in our grocery list to store garlic instead of onion. And then when we printed the table again, we can see that change. First key now stores garlic, and the second key, third key, and fourth key are still the same. An onion is nowhere to be found anymore. But then we changed our minds again and decided that we do want to buy an onion. So we assigned that to the fifth key, which was free. It wasn't taken. So then when we printed that table, we can see onion again. The first, second, third, and fourth keys are still the same as before. Garlic, carrot, lettuce, and potato. But the fifth key has been assigned to onion. So we've added a new value to our table after creating it. And we can do this again and add some celery to our list. So we will index the next available key after 5, which should be 6, and we can assign that to some celery. And then let's print the table again and run the code. So we can see that the celery has been assigned to the 6th key. So this is how we can add new items to a table after creating it. But what if you don't specifically know what the next available key of our table is? Visually, we can see that the next key will be 7. But what if you don't know that in our code? Using the hash operator, we can find out the length of a table. When we use the hash operator on the table, it tells us the table's length, or its size. So it tells us how many key value pairs there are in this table. So let's test this out. And we can see it says 6. So it's telling us that there are 6 key value pairs in our table. And we can use this to find the next available key in our table and add new values to the end of it when we don't know what that key is specifically. So we can do grocery list, square brackets, and we will index the next available key. So that would be hash grocery list, which should be 6, and we'll add 1 to it to get to 7. And this should now index the next available key in our table. And let's assign that to some taro. Then let's print the grocery list one more time. And then run the code. Now let's just expand the output. And we'll just expand these two tables. So we can see that the string taro has been assigned to the 7th key. Because we indexed the key that was the length of the table at that time plus 1. The length of that table was 6. And then adding 1 to it will give us the 7th key, which is the next available key in our table. Another thing to keep in mind regarding tables is that each key must be unique, so a table cannot have 2 of the same keys. So if you try to add 1 as a key to the table again, it will just overwrite the previous key. It's not going to add another first key. And as you can see, it just replaced the old value assigned to key 1 with a new value. But now that our grocery list is ready, let's buy all of the items that are on the list. We'll start by creating a function to buy items. So local function, and we'll just name it buy, and don't forget to add the parentheses, and the name of our parameter can just be item. And inside the body of the function, we will just print bought item, like that. This is our simple buy function. It just takes any value as an input and prints out bought that value. Next, we'll go through each item in our grocery list and run them through our buy function. We'll start with the first item in the list at key 1 and work our way down. So local item equals grocery list square brackets 1, and we will send that to our buy function. Let's just test this and see if it's working so far. And there we go, it printed out that it bought garlic, because garlic is the first value in our table. So now let's do the same for the rest of our items. We have 7 items in total, so we'll need to copy and paste 7 times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And let's just change these, so that'll be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Now let's run the code. And we can see that it's working fine. We're fetching each item in our grocery list table, and we are running each of them through our by function. It printed out that it bought garlic, carrot, lettuce, potato, onion, celery, and taro. But as you can see, this is all very long-winded. Having to copy and paste these instructions for each item is very tedious, and it won't scale well if we add more and more items to the grocery list. We can simplify all of this to a single loop, which goes through each key value pair in our table and lets us run some code with them. This process is known as iteration, and this loop is the second type of for loops, which is known as the generic for loop. So to create one, we start with the keyword for, and then we follow it with some variable names. These variables will store the key value pairs of our table on each iteration or loop. So we'll need 2 variable names, one for the keys of the table and the other for the values assigned to them. So our variable name for the keys can just be key, and the name for the values can just be item. I don't forget to separate them with a comma. So for key, comma, item. Next, we specify which table we want to iterate over. So we use the keyword in and follow it with our grocery list table. And then finally, we write do and hit enter and write whatever code we want to repeat between the do and end. So this for loop will go through each key value pair in our grocery list table. At each pair, the key will be assigned to the key variable and the value will be assigned to our item variable. And any code between the do and end will be repeated. Just to test our loop, let's print out the keys and items. So print key, comma, item. And then let's run the code. And there we go. The for loop ran through each key value pair in our table and printed them out. So now that we have easy access to each item in the grocery list, let's buy them again. So we'll just replace this line with buy item. So we're going to send each item to our buy function. And now let's run the code. And there we go, it's running perfectly. So this is how we iterate or loop over tables. We use the generic for loop to go through each key value pair in the table, and we can run a block of code with them. There are other ways to iterate over tables too. Some of them only work with specific types of tables, which we'll learn in the next lesson. Although the method we've learned so far is the simplest method and it works with all types of tables, you'll often encounter other methods in other scripters' code, so it's best that we go through them. One method is to wrap the table after the in keyword of the for loop in a built-in function called ipairs, so like this. So we send the table as an argument to this ipairs function. This method starts from the first key of the table, key 1, and continues until it reaches a nil value. So in an array like this, it will stop at the 5th key because the 6th key is missing. And in an array like this, it will stop at the 2nd key because the 3rd key is missing since it has been assigned to nil. But if you remove the ipairs iterator function in this example, the for loop will now skip the nil value and move to the 4th key. Although this first method is the simplest to use and easiest to remember, it's good to learn other methods of iterating over tables, which you might prefer to use in a specific scenario. And we'll cover the rest of them in the next lesson. There is a lot more to cover about tables because they're very important and can be found everywhere in Lua, but we'll stop here for this lesson. If you do have any questions, please feel free to send them in the comment section and I'll try to respond as soon as I can. And if you'd like some assignments to help you practice what you've learned so far, you can try to create a function that takes 2 tables and merges them together. So it takes the values from one table and adds them to the other. And if you're feeling adventurous, you could also try to create a custom iterator function that iterates over a table backwards. So it starts from the last key and ends at the first key. I'll add my own solutions to these problems in the video's description too. And again, thank you all for watching. I'll see you in the next one.